Hello, my name is James Sims. I'm a member of the Professional Activities Committee. Welcome this afternoon to the Foreign Correspondents Club. I would like to just briefly introduce the people at the head table. Our speaker today, Mr. Jiro Ono, and a writer and food critic, Mr. Masuhiro Yamamoto, is immediately to his right. And then on the far right, or I guess your far left, is our interpreter, Ms. Takamatsu. Yes?
And then his son, Yoshi.
Yes. And to my immediate right is Mr. Yoshikazu, Ono's, his oldest son, yeah. Mr. Yoshikazu Ono. Yes.
Yes.
Anyway, as many of you who've probably been in Japan for even a week or two, or even, you know, 10 years or 20 years, you know that sushi has become one of Japan's largest or biggest sort of cultural imports, and one of the leading figures in Japan's, I would say, I guess, sushi culture is our guest speaker today. He has been, he had received 3 stars from the Michelin guide for his restaurant, I believe, from the first time they started rating restaurants in Tokyo. And he was also the subject of a documentary which was nominated, I believe, for an Academy Award. He has been a very sort of tireless, I think, promoter of Japanese sushi culture. And that's our guest speaker. That's our guest speaker today, Mr. Jiro Ono. And then to his right is a food critic and author who was one of the first people to introduce Mr. Ono to the world in his guidebook, Tokyo Taste Grand Prix, which introduced Mr. Ono to the world. And he has also co-authored another book, which I believe is on the front table. It's a very short, very interesting English and Japanese guide to sushi. It not only goes through the different types of sushi, but also tells you how to eat sushi, I think both with your hand and your chopsticks as well. Anyway, but without any further ado, I'd like to introduce our speaker, Mr. Jiro Ono.
Hello, I've just been introduced. My name is Jiro Ono, and I am the proprietor of Sukiyaki Jiro. I have been a sushi shop, I have run my sushi shop for the past 55 years, but I am still very far from retirement. I am a working sushi chef, so I thank you very much for this opportunity today. Excuse me, the interpreter. It's Sukiyabashi Jiro. I don't think the interpreter had a moment. Excuse me. Apparently, there is an actual different restaurant called Sukiyaki Jiro, but of course, the interpreter has made a tremendous mistake. Apologies.
Oh, and I think I was remiss. Mr. Yamamoto was actually supposed to speak a few words about his working relationship on the book with Mr. Ono, as well as what makes Mr. Ono, I guess, is who's been called sort of the superstar of sort of the sushi world.
Hi. Ono-Jiro-san. 10月の27日で満89歳、89歳で現役で寿司職人、いや寿司職人ではなくても、ギネスブックに登録されているミシュランで最年長三つ星シェフというふうに、記録されているんですが、8歳の時からですね、あ、7歳ですか、
7歳ですか、
8歳の時から仕事を始めました。学校行きながらですよ、小学校行きながら。ですから職歴、仕事をして81年でありますよ。
Hello, I've just been introduced. I'm going to talk a little bit about Mr. Jiro Ono, who is very famous. On October 27th of this year, he celebrated his 89th birthday. He is, as was explained earlier, a working sushi chef. And not only this, but he is recorded in the Guinness Book of World Records as being the oldest chef who has been the proprietor of a 3-star Michelin restaurant. He began work, however, when he was only 80 years old. So he has had a working career of 81 years.
数日前に、我が国から 王寿褒章というご褒美を次郎さんいただいたんですが、89歳にならないと王寿褒章がいただけないかなというふうにちょっぴり、まあ、びっくらしたんですが、でも個人でいただくのは極めて異例だそうでして、次郎さんがその王寿褒章に値して本当に良かったなと正直思っています。
As many of you may be aware, several days ago it was announced that Mr. Ono Jiro-san would be the recipient of a very famous decoration by the Japanese government, which is the Medal of the Yellow Ribbon, Medal with the Yellow Ribbon. Of course, it is a great honor, but my first thought was that do you have to be 89 years old before you can receive such a wonderful award? Still, however, the fact is that it's very unusual for this award to be given to a single individual. And so I'm very, very glad that he has been given this award.
私が次郎さんのお寿司を食べたのが今から34年ぐらい前です。
I first had the opportunity to taste Jiro-san's sushi 34 years ago.
名は知られてましたが、今ほどこんなに有名ではなかったと思います。
Even back then he was well known. However, he was not as famous as he is today.
で私も実を言うと次郎さんのお店に出かけてった時に次郎さんは握ってくれませんでした。
Actually, I visited Jiro-san's shop actually several times, but I was not fortunate enough to have him actually make my sushi for me.
お昼の時間に行ったんですが、まあ、常連さんが必ずいるんで、ちょうどお店を閉める直前なら握ってくれるかなと思って1時半少し前に出かけていきました。34年前のことです。
This was 34 years ago and I was trying to be very calculating. I thought that if I could get to the store just a little after the lunchtime crowd had left and just before closing time, then I might be able to slip in and have Jiro-san actually make the sushi for me. In other words, during lunchtime, the customers are all regulars. It's very, very difficult to get in.
そうしましたら、一仕事終わってしまったのか、入り口のところで新聞読んでらしたもう。
However, even though I tried to time my visits very carefully and get there just before closing time around 1 p.m., every time I went, Jiro-san had apparently just finished making sushi for his lunch regulars, and he was sitting outside his shop reading a newspaper.
で、お寿司いただけますかって言ったら、どうぞ奥へって送られてしまいました。
And when I approached him and said, could you please make me some sushi? Could I have some of your wonderful sushi? He said, yes, please go inside. There's some available.
で、中のカウンターにいたのが職人さんで、それが今三つ星を取ってらっしゃる水谷さんでした。
In fact, when I went inside, it was another person, another chef, that actually prepared my sushi for me. The person that prepared my sushi was wonderful in his own right. His name was Mr. Mizutani, and he is now the proprietor of another 3-star restaurant.
で、お寿司は6つしか食べませんでした。
And when I first went, I only had 6 pieces of sushi.
なぜかというと、お金がなかったのと、2軒はしごしてたからです、他のお寿司屋さんと比べるために。
There were several reasons for this. One is that I didn't have enough money to pay for more sushi. And the other reason was because I was working as a food critic, I was visiting two restaurants at the same time. Therefore, I could not eat so much.
今でも6つ食べて帰るってことはできませんよ、次郎さんでは。
I think many of you may be aware of this, but you cannot have only 6 pieces of sushi at Jiro-san's restaurant now.
はい、その時に出したガイドブックがこの東京味のグランプリ200という、これ1982年に出しました。
To explain this, I should go back a little bit. In 1982, I published this guidebook called, which is called Tokyo Taste Grand Prix 200.
で、私は次郎さんのところで結局2度目に3ヶ月後にもう一度訪ねたんですが、その時も中に送られてしまいました。
So I've told you about my first experience to Jiro-san's restaurant. The second time was 3 months later. I tried a similar approach and I was hoping that this time Jiro-san might prepare my sushi for me. But again, I was unsuccessful. He said, please go inside. Someone will prepare it for you.
お勘定の時だけ次郎さんが立つんです。
The only time Jiro-san was kind enough to stand up was when I paid my bill.
もうそれで思い切ってドキドキしながらお勘定を支払いながら、今度来た時は次郎さんが握ったお寿司いただきたいですって言ったんです。
So I decided to be very courageous, although my heart was beating quite rapidly. I asked Jiro-san, even as I was paying my bill, the next time I come, could you please make this sushi for me?
そうしましたら突然次郎さんの目がピカッと光って、 あなたそんなつもりで来てたのっていう感じでしたね。はい。
When I said that, Jiro-san's eyes suddenly lit up. There was a spark in his eyes, and he said, "Oh, well, that's why you've been coming several times."
で、それが忘れられないうちにと思いまして、1週間後に3度目出かけていきました。
And since he seemed to react very, very favorably towards me, I wanted him to remember me, so I went back a week later.
お腹が空いてたんですけど、やっぱり6つしか食べませんでした。
This time I was quite hungry, but again, my pocketbook and I had a discussion, and I was only able to have 6 pieces again.
とても高いお寿司だったんで、私にとっては30年前。
30 years ago, it was very expensive sushi for me.
で、初めて二郎さんが1対1で握ってくださいました。
But that was my first wonderful opportunity to have Jiro-san actually prepare my sushi for me one-on-one.
でこのガイドブック、表紙からして赤いのはミシュランをとても意識して、この当時日本ではほとんど誰もミシュランはご存知でありませんでした。
As I mentioned, this book was published in 1982. I was very, very conscious of trying to respect Michelin's red guidebook. But at that time, very few people in Japan knew about the Michelin guides.
でこの中でお寿司屋さん、私東京中100軒ぐらい食べたんですが、
And in order to prepare this book, I visited over 100 different sushi shops in Tokyo.
ただし当時電話帳を見ると9500件もありました。もう当時お寿司屋さんは。
That may sound like a very large number. However, in the phone book at that time, there were over 9500 sushi shops listed.
回転寿司がない時代ですよ。
And this was before you had the 回転寿司, which is where you have the conveyor belts carrying the sushis around.
そのうちの4件のうちの1件が二郎さん三つ星をつけました。
And of the four top restaurants that were included in this guidebook, there was just one, Jiro-san's restaurant, that was given the 3 stars.
で、そこで私がずっとお寿司屋さんもお蕎麦屋さんも寿司そば天ぷらうなぎというのは東京の郷土料理です。
Since that time, after that time, I went and visited many other restaurants. And at that time, when we talked about Tokyo cuisine.We basically thought about sushi, soba, noodles, and tempura.
あとそれにとんかつとラーメンを加えた6ジャンルをこのガイドブックで200件紹介しました。
We also included other very, very popular kinds of foods, tonkatsu, which is fried pork dishes, and also ramen noodles. In total, we included 200 restaurants in this guidebook.
で、ここの中の三つ星をつけたお店の味というよりも、そこのご主人、料理長、職人さん、に共通しているのがあるんですね。
Of the restaurants that received 3 stars, I think there were several different aspects or elements or factors that were very common among all of these restaurants. And it has to do with, of course, the taste of each particular restaurant and also the nature of the proprietor, the head chef.
5つの条件があると思うんです。
I think there are 5 requirements or 5 conditions that must be met before a person can be given a 3-star.
第一は勤勉であること、真面目であること。
First of all, a chef of a restaurant must be extremely diligent and hardworking.
なぜかというと、昨日うまくできて今日うまくいかなかったっていうことは許されないので。
In other words, the restaurant world is very, very severe. You cannot have a good day and a bad day. Every day the food must be wonderful.
2番目は清潔感。
Second condition is that a person must be very clean and you must give the feeling, impression of being very clean.
今日二郎さんは私服でいらしてますが、白衣を着ているとき本当にシミがついてない汚れがのついてない白衣をいつもきれいにきちんと着こなしていらっしゃいます。
As you can see, Jiro-san today has come in a private dress. However, normally when he is working, he is wearing a white sort of uniform that sushi chefs wear, and there is not a single stain, there's nothing unclean about it at all.
おそらく世界一掃除の行き届いた清潔感あふれたお店が二郎だと思います。
I believe very strongly,
世界一ですよ。
I believe very strongly that Jiro-san's restaurant is probably the cleanest, most carefully cleaned and looked after restaurant in the world.
二郎さんのモットーは料理するっていうことは調理半分と掃除半分だ。いつも言ってらっしゃいます。
Actually, Jiro-san always says the secret to preparing a wonderful food and to having a wonderful restaurant is half it has to be the actual cooking.A part, and half of it has to be the actual cleaning part.
3つ目、向上心。
And the third requirement.
昨日より今日、今日より明日、もっと上手くなりたいって思う気持ちが大切。
And the third requirement for a wonderful chef is that you always want to be more ambitious. You want to constantly improve. Whatever you did today is not good enough for tomorrow.
今言った3つはとてもどの社会でもメリットとして歓迎されると思うんですが、あとの2つは 会社ですとかグループだとあんまりメリットにならないかなと思うんですけど、料理人にはとても必要なことです。短期。
So, I've listed three qualities. I've listed three qualities that are important for a head chef, but I think you can understand that these are qualities that are considered admirable regardless of your profession. However, there are two other requirements to making a great chef, and these two other requirements perhaps are not good qualities to have if you're working in an organization, if you're a company employee. First of all, you have to be short-tempered.
あんまり気の長い人にいい料理人は見てないですね、この40年。はい、
I've been working in the food industry for 40 years. I've never really seen a wonderful chef who has great patience.
あと5つ目、わがまま。
And the fifth quality is わがまま, which can be translated as a stubbornness, the unwillingness to compromise.
いつでもわが道を行く。はい、そういうこの5つの条件に全部かなっている一人がこの小野次郎でありまして。
I believe that you have to be stubborn enough to go your own way, regardless of what other people say. These are the five qualities that I think must be had by any great chef, and I believe these are the five qualities that are possessed by Mr. Jiro.
さらにそこに仕事に対するパッション、情熱を持ち続けている完璧主義者だと思います、私は。
If I were to add some other qualities that Jiro-san possesses, I think it is that, first of all, he has...continual passion for his work. He's never lost this passion for his work, and he's also a great perfectionist.
国から報奨をいただこうが、今から、かなり前なんですが、80歳の時に現代の名工という、これもご褒美を国からいただいたんですが、お昼にその授与式があった後、もう夜きちんと仕事してましたからね。
Whether he receives an award from the government or not, he continues to be devoted to his work. We know that he is being awarded this yellow ribbon medal later this month. However, when he was 80 years old, he received another award from the government, which can be translated as a great craftsman of the modern times. There was a wonderful ceremony during the daytime. However, after he attended that, he immediately, in the evening, was standing behind the sushi counter serving his customers.
はい、ですから今も本当にお昼も夜もお客様すべてに吉和さんがお魚を切りつけて次郎さんが握ると、毎日つけ台に立ってずっと立ち仕事です。
So again, even today, day and night, during the lunch hour and during the dinner hour, Mr. Jiro is always working. It is his eldest son, Yoshikazu-san, who actually slices the fish and other ingredients. But in the final moment, it is Jiro-san who actually puts together the sushi, prepares the sushi, and he's standing the entire time.
そんなに立ち仕事でずっと未だに立っててくたびれないですかって聞いたことあるんです。
Some time ago, I asked Jiro-san, don't you get tired from standing so many long hours each day?
8歳から、もう仕事に学校に行きながら仕事に、出かけてったかっていうか、奉公で、まあ、料理旅館で働いてたわけなんですけど、宿題なんか一度もしなかったって、できる時間がなくて学校でいつも立たされてたそうなんですね。だからちっちゃい時から立つことには慣れてたって。
The way he responded was that he said that, you know, I've been working since I was only 80 years old. I was apprenticed to a large Japanese style inn, a Japanese restaurant. And so even though I was going to elementary school, I had to work all the time. I had no time for homework. And because I had no time for homework, I would go to school and I would be made to stand outside the hall. So I've always been used to standing even since I was a small child.
ということで、いまだに現役でやってらっしゃるんですが、こんなに世界中に広まるきっかけになったというのは、映画が一番大きいかな。ミシュランで三つ星を取ったこともありますが、世界中からお客様が今いらっしゃるということは、ジロードリームスオブスシーというハリウッドのドキュメンタリー映画が一番影響が大きいかなというふうに思います。
So again, he is serving as the sushi chef even today. And you know that he is very, very famous throughout the world. I think the most immediate cause for his great fame throughout the world is because of this Hollywood produced documentary film, which is called Jiro Dreams of Sushi. That has garnered attention from people throughout the world. Of course, he was famous before that because he did receive the 3 stars from Michelin, but I think it is the film that has transformed his fame.
もう本当に、アメリカ、ヨーロッパ、アジア、中近東、世界中のあらゆるところから次郎さんのところに予約が入って、なんと夜は7割ぐらいで、そうです、 7割ぐらいは外国の人だそうです。
So he is famous throughout the United States, Europe, Asia, and Middle East. People come from all over the world to sit at his counter. In fact, during the dinner hour, 70% of the guests are actually foreign.
だからそこに一組の日本人がいて、あと他の方が全員外国の方だと、ここ日本じゃないみたいですね。おっしゃるそうです。
There are many evenings when there's only one couple out of all of the people at the restaurant that are Japanese, and they quite often murmur to themselves, "This doesn't feel like as though we're in Japan anymore."
で、いらっしゃるところをこう見ると、特にヨーロッパの方の着こなしからして非常にこう敬意を持ってお店を訪ねてきたさる、お店の地下、ビルの地下にあるなんてヨーロッパでは考えられないことですね。一流のお店は必ず地上にあって、次郎はなんと地下にあるお店なんですが、きちんとそれに対しても服装から何から敬意を持ってきてくださるのはとても嬉しいと。
In regard to the people who actually visit the shop, quite often people, especially if they are from Europe, because they have heard of the reputation of Jiro-san's restaurant, they dress up in their finest, prepared to show their respect to the chef. However, they're quite often surprised when they actually see the shop, because first of all, it's underground. It's in the basement floor of an office building, and that's something that is unthinkable for a very high-quality, luxurious restaurant in Europe. They're all above ground, of course.
お箸の使い方もとても上手な方もたくさんお見受けするそうです、外国の方で。
Jiro-san has often expressed surprise by the fact that so many of these foreign guests are very, very skilled at using the chopsticks.
でも中には日本人も含めて、お寿司の食べ方がどうもちょっと違うぞという方、外国の方も含めてたくさんいらっしゃるみたいなんですね。
Having said this, however, he is slightly sometimes a little saddened by the fact that not only the sometimes among the foreign guests, but even among the Japanese guests, there's not necessarily a deep understanding of the proper way to eat sushi.
そこでジローガストロノミーという皆さんに今日お配りしているポケットブックを作ろうと。いうことになりました。
It was for this reason that we decided to produce this little booklet, which has actually been distributed to all of you, called Gastronomy, which talks about the proper way to have sushi.
これは二郎さんの寿司種を一つ一つ30種類紹介しているだけじゃなくて、二郎さんが実を言うと一番この本で大事だと思っているのは後半の部分なんです。食べ方の部分なんです。
In other words, the first part of the book covers 30 different kinds of sushi that Jiro-san is famous for preparing. However, Jiro-san himself is more interested in the latter part of the book, which talks about the proper way to actually enjoy sushi.
Jiro-san 常々おっしゃって、後でもご自身でもお話ししてくださると思うんですが、美味しいお寿司っていうのは握って出すだけじゃない。食べる方の人が上手に食べてくれて、美味しいお寿司は完成すると。そんなふうにおっしゃってます。
I'm sure Jiro-san will talk about this himself in a few moments, but he always says that delicious sushi is only half the responsibility of the chef. In other words, the chef prepares the sushi, but the rest of the delicious experience is due to the actual person who is enjoying the sushi.
今までお寿司の本に限らず料理の本って作る方の本ばっかりであります。レシピ本。
And I think this is a very, very important point because when we look at a different food-related books, whether they are books about teaching recipes or whether they are talking about different restaurants, the primary focus has been on the chef, the producing of the dishes part.
おそらく初めて食べ方を添えたお寿司の本が出ました。昨年世界無形文化遺産に和食がなりました。寿司も和食であります。それが世界に広まる中でこういう食べ方の本がきちんと伝わったらいいなというふうなことで、この一応本の詳細は次郎さんと私という形で出させていただきました。
So I think this is rather, although it's a small book, it is a very, very unusual book about sushi because I think it is the first book about sushi that actually tells you how to enjoy sushi, how to eat sushi. As you know, last year, sushi was declared one of the World Heritage assets, something that belongs to all of humanity. And I believe, therefore, it is very timely to produce such a book.
さあ、これから皆さんのご質問を受けたいと思いますが、あと2つだけお話しさせてください。
So we're going to turn to the question and answer session in a few minutes, but before that I'd like to mention two points.
なぜ次郎が傑出して素晴らしい寿司屋なのか。
I'm sure this first question is very much on everyone's minds. What makes Jiro-san's sushi so special, so distinctive?
非常に伝統的な江戸前というスタイルのお寿司をやりながら、とても新しいことの試みを、ネタを変えずに、寿司種を変えずに、それをもっと美味しくできないかっていう、まあメニューは変わらないけれどもバージョンアップするっていうのが二郎のスタイルであります。
I think if I were to describe Jiro-san's sushi, it is that, first of all, he values tradition. In other words, his sushi is very, very much based on the historical Edo-mae sushi, which is the traditional kind of sushi that was served during the Edo period in Edo, in Tokyo. But at the same time, while he respects tradition, he is unafraid to bring a new twist, innovation, into the sushi world. In other words, he does not change the ingredients, but he takes a different approach to try to make the taste more new and somehow more refreshing and more tasty.
例えば、まあ、例はいくつもあるんです。一つ挙げますと、エビというのはだいたい朝湯がいたものを晩でも出してました。昔のお寿司屋は、はい、それをお客様の注文を受けてからエビを握るようになったのは二郎さんが初めてであります。今から30年前のことで。
There are many, many ways, many, many examples that I can give you. But for example, one, is that traditionally, when you had prawns or shrimp at a sushi restaurant, that shrimp or prawn was boiled early in the morning and it was served throughout the day, even if you came at dinner time. However, even 30 years ago, Jiro-san tried something completely different, which was that he did not start to prepare the shrimp, boil the shrimp, until the customer ordered it.
あと30年前のご存知のお方たくさんいると思うんですが、マグロから必ず出してました、お寿司というのは。
Another very, very distinctive new thing that he brought into the sushi world was that 30 years ago, I'm sure many of you have experienced this three decades ago, it used to be that when you started to have a sushi meal, the first thing that was produced was always cuts of tuna.
それが私はこのガイドで、二郎さんのところの白身が、白身というのはヒラメとか、まあ、夏場だったらカレーなんですが、冬だったらヒラメ。その白身がこんなに美味しいのにマグロを先に食べてしまっては、もったいないんではないかなって書いたんですね。はい。
And the reason for this change that occurred for Jiro-san, I think was caused by my book, because I described in very glowing terms Jiro-san's sushi restaurant, but I said it is a shame if you start with the maguro or the tuna, because then you cannot enjoy the subtle delicacy of the white fishes that come later. And the white fishes, for example, in the wintertime, it would be hirame, which is flounder or halibut, or in during the summer months, it might be kare, which is another name for flounder or sole.
フランス料理でも前菜の後にメインディッシュが来る、重いものが来る、軽いものから重たいもの、ワインだって若いものから熟成したものへとだんだんこうグラデュエイトしていく。
In other words, when we look at French cuisine, there is a gradation in the wines and the foods that are presented. For example, you start with something very light, like an appetizer, and then you move towards something much heavier and richer. It's with the same with wines. You start with a very young, light wine and move to more mature, heavier wines.
で今ご自分が考えられた20貫のコースというお任せコースというのを二郎さんでは出しています。これが非常にユニークな点の第一点。
So, I mentioned earlier that it's not possible to only have six pieces of sushi at Jiro-san's restaurant now. Everything is a special set course, and it is composed of 20 pieces of sushi, and that is all that is served. This, I think, is also very unique.
もう一つは江戸前ということです。
And the other part of that is unique about Jiro-san's presentation, besides him having this 20-piece sushi meal, which is very gradated, is that he focuses on this edomai sushi, this historical.
だいたい江戸前というのは東京湾、江戸城の前の海で取れたっていう意味で江戸前、前というのはインフロントオブで使ってます。
So just to give you an explanation, 江戸前 means in front of Tokyo, and what that means is that it refers to Tokyo Bay, which is right in front of the city of Edo and Edo Castle.
でもティーセレモニーの時、お茶の時、お手前という時も前を使いますよね。
But there are other uses for the word mae. I mentioned earlier that it means in front of, but it is also, there's another word called otemae, which also uses the mae in the tea ceremony.
自前とも言いますよね。my style ですね。
Again, the word mae is used in many, many different ways. 自前 means, it means in front of, but it also means producing your own pocketbook.
男前とも言います。
And there's also another word called 男前, which means man in front of, which means a man, a person who looks very good on the front. He's very handsome.
ですから、お手前、 自前、男前っていうのはインフロントオブじゃなくてスタイル、流儀です。
What I'm trying to get at is in all of these other terms that we're talking about, whether we're talking about tea ceremony or the way a person looks, or with the way one presents one's ideas, it's basically not in front of, but it means style.
じゃあ江戸前というのは江戸スタイルというのはどういうことか。
So what I'm getting at is that Edomai, which is usually translated as being in front of Tokyo or Tokyo Bay, actually has another nuance, which is that it's Edo style. What does this mean?
お寿司は関西の方から伝わってきました。
As many of you may know, the sushi tradition originally came from the Kansai or Western Japan area to Tokyo.
押し寿司バッテラのようにもう形をご飯と上のお魚を形を決めたやつを1日経ってから食べると美味しかったりなんかします。
Western style Japanese sushi is very, very different in style. It is not prepared one piece at a time, but rather it is put into a mold. You have the rice, vinegared rice, and you have the different ingredients that you put on top, and you press it into a mold, and you let it sit for a day. That's supposed to be the tastiest way to have this.
それを東京では気が短いからみんなお酢の酢飯を作っといて。上のお魚にもちゃんと味を締め、味をつけといて、で注文があったらすぐ握って出す。
But everything changed with sushi when it moved to Tokyo because again people in Tokyo are very very busy. They have very short tempers. They can't wait a day for sushi to be developed. So a way of responding to the needs of the Tokyo people developed, or the Edo people developed, which was that one created the vinegared rice in advance. One also made sure that the ingredients were brushed with some kind of a sauce to begin with, so you didn't have to worry about the taste.
それが江戸時代に屋台で始まりました。
And because this was something very much for the masses, it was served in food stalls out in the streets.
お客さんが来ては注文してはさっさと握ってくれたのを食べて、
In other words, it was a kind of a fast food restaurant in that people would step into this food stall, order something, immediately the vinegared rice would be made into a little ball and the flavored ingredients would be put on top and the customer would be able to eat very quickly.
箸も使いませんでした。
It was so quick that people didn't even use chopsticks.
屋台ですから洗い物も少ない方がいるのでお醤油の小皿もありませんでした。
And back then, again, we were working with food stalls. You didn't have plumbing or anything like that. It was very difficult to be able to wash things, so they did not have soy sauce little bowls.
上にハケでお醤油を塗りました。
So again, as I mentioned, instead, the ingredients were brushed with soy sauce beforehand.
だから握ったのをそのままダイレクトに口に運べば美味しくいただけました。
In other words, when a piece of sushi was prepared for you, you could immediately pop it into your mouth.
アナゴなどは甘い爪って言うんですけども、甘いソースをつけてくださって、つまり2種類のソースがありました。
Also, I mentioned earlier that the sushi ingredients were brushed with soy sauce, but there was another slightly sweeter sauce that could be used for other ingredients, such as for anago, which is called conjured eel or saltwater eel.
Excuse me, Yamamoto-san, could we get, we need to get to the Q&A because we're running out of time here. So, okay, sorry about that.
はい、じゃあ最後の一つ。ですから、今、アナゴの爪はどこのお店もあるんですが、お醤油は、これはお寿司屋さんのタイマンかな。ほとんど出すところがありません。クラシックのお店では出します。
その、はい。And, in fact, there was this special...
辛いお醤油は自分でつけなきゃいけない。はい。
So again, there are different kinds of sauces, and for the conjured eel, apparently it's a much more, thicker soy sauce that is prepared. But they're not because it's a lot of extra work to prepare this extra sauce. Very few sushi shops actually prepare this special sauce now.
ですからお酒も飲まない、おしゃべりもしない、これが一番の江戸前なんです。
So again, this Edo style, how is it distinguished? First of all, it's very fast. It's so fast that not even sake, alcohol, is served, and there is no time for conversation.
だから二郎では、お酒も出さない、おしゃべりもできないって言いますがこれが一番基本に立ち戻った江戸前をやってる世界で唯一のお店です。
So, はい、以上です。Jiro-san's shop again is very, very unusual because of all of the sushi shops in the world, it's probably the only one where there is no sake served and you're not really allowed to have conversation. And yet, he is successful. Thank you.
Thank you. That was actually very fascinating. I would have liked to have heard more, but we just had to get to the Q&A. So I'd like to go to questions from the working press.And if you just keep it to one question, if we have time, we can go back around. And I don't expect any speeches about sushi, so I won't say that. So I'll go ahead with you.
Siegfried Knittel, freelancer from Germany. I think a bit in what I heard, what I learned, and I understood a little bit from what you told us now is, in former times, sushi was a kind of food for normally people walking, perhaps walking in the Skitchy area, and they ate it in the morning. Sometimes very fast, and but you said it ate it very fast. So in this way, this was not a kind of a high culture food. Now it developed to a kind of a high culture food. It's more before it was like fast food. Now it's kind of art. So in this way, it's for me a bit difficult to understand to say if you say. It's Chiro-san style is still Edo-mai style. If I see on the other side this development from kind of more fast food type to this kind of art style sushi.
はい、ドイツのフリーのものでございます。フリーランスのものでございます。今お話を聞いていて非常に興味深いお話だったのでございますが、私の理解が正しければ、もともと江戸前寿司といいますのは、まあ、一般の人たち向けのものだった、労働者向けのものというふうに私は聞いております。築地市場などで働いている人たちが、例えば朝召し上がったようなお料理だというふうに聞いているのでございます。しかしながら今、寿司ということを考えますと、非常にその高級なイメージ、高級料理というイメージがあるのでございます。教養人が、文化人が上がるようなものというふうに感じるんでございますが、しかしなんかお話を聞いておりますと、もともとファストフードだったものが、まあ、こういうような芸術 の, そのものになってしまったということでございますが、しかしながら同時に二郎さんのお寿司は江戸前寿司、その伝統を重んじているというふうにおっしゃるんですが、このなんとなく相反するような感じがするんでございますが、ちょっとご説明いただけますでしょうか。
はい、江戸時代はスナックでありました。なぜかというと、築地で食べられたというよりも、江戸時代は単身の男が圧倒的に多かったんですね。ですからその人たちの食事のためにファーストフードとしてお寿司もそばも天ぷらも東京中で、まあ、江戸時代流行ったんですね。そこがスターターです。でそこから始まりましたが、やっぱり何の料理でもそうですけども、一つの料理が郷土料理からオートキズイヌ高級料理に行く道がありまして、やっぱり江戸前といってもいまだに回転寿司の中でも酢飯の温度は人肌っていうような、人間の体温に近い温度で酢飯を握るっていうふうなことをやってるところもきちんとあります。ですから一つのスナックから150年200年経ったうちに、こういう高級な芸術といっていうような、今おっしゃったように芸術といっていうような料理も出てきたということだと思います。両方混在してます。二郎さんはおそらく両方ともお寿司だって言われると思います。
So yeah, after that, if Mr. Ono, if he had any comments on that, I'd love to hear them as well.
Okay. Yes. As you pointed out, during the Edo period, sushi was basically a snack, a light snack. And the part of the reason for that was of the demographics at that time. It's not just the working people who worked in Tsukiji fish market that had the sushi, but actually there was a preponderance of single men that lived in Tokyo. Or they might have been married, but they would have left their wives or in families back in the regions. So they were there working just in Edo on their own. And there was this tremendous need to feed these people. And that's why all of this kind of fast food, whether we're talking about sushi or soba noodles, which you can eat very fast, and tempura, developed. But as with any kind of cooking, even though the roots might have been quite humble to begin with, over time, there are people who come and try to bring it to the next level, and as you have pointed out, bring it to the level of art. Still, when we talk about the fast foods that we see in Japan today, the conveyor belt kaiten sushi, sushi shops, there are some that still, even though it looks like fast food on the surface, take great care and skill in preparing the sushi. For example, they're very, very careful about the temperature of the vinaigrette rice, to make sure that it is the exact temperature of a person's body, which is considered to be the most tasty, savory temperature. Yes, it started out as very simple snack fast food 150, 200 years ago, but over time, there have been people who have brought it to the artistic level. There is a combination of both, and probably Jiro-san would say they both are sushi. で、恐縮ございますが、Jiro-sama も何かコメントいただけますでしょうか?
ジローさんのところのお寿司だけがジローさんお寿司と思ってないで、回転寿司も食べたことありますよね。
あります。勉強のため、勉強のために、お寿司というのはあるとあらゆる寿司を私は味わっております。
で、ご自身が飯作ってるだけがお寿司じゃないですよね。ジローさんよく言いますけど。
これはもう全部自分たちが研究して、進歩しなかったら、お寿司もあまり値打ちがないと思いますので、自分はそれなりの勉強はしていると思ってやっております。
And yes, Jiro-san is saying that I've been to conveyor belt sushi restaurants as well. I try everything because I think what is truly important in the world of sushi or in the world of any cuisine is to constantly research, constantly try to think about the next step. Unless you have this sort of intense focus on trying to develop one's cuisine to the next level, eventually the value or worth of that cuisine will diminish.
Okay, is that Richard?
Yes.
インドネシアの新聞記者リチャール・ソシロと申します。ジローのマスター様遅れたなんですけれども、お誕生日おめでとうございます。すみません。誕生日おめでとうございます。こちらの資料に書いてありますので、7割ぐらい外国人の方なんですけれども、私の質問なんですけれども、海外にお店開いた方がいいじゃないですかね。例えばインドネシアに。インドネシアはですね、寿司がものすごい人気ありますので、いかがでしょうか。よろしくお願いします。
So, representing an Indonesian newspaper, and I'd like first of all to wish Mr. Jiro a happy birthday. And you mentioned earlier that 70% of your customers are foreigners. Therefore, would you perhaps think about opening a restaurant abroad, especially in my country, Indonesia, where sushi is very, very popular? Would you consider that?
これはもう皆さんからよく言われる話なんですけれども、私は自分の目が届く範囲でなかったら支店を出そうとは思っておりません。これは自分の名前も落ちますし、お寿司の値打ちも下がりますので、これだけはやらないようにしております。今まではずいぶん皆さんからそう言われましたけど、未だにまだやっておりません。
Thank you very much for your comments. Actually, I have received similar comments many times in the past. However, I feel very strongly that I do not want to open a restaurant where my eyesight, where things in the restaurant cannot be seen by myself. In other words, I do not want to open a restaurant and not be 100% responsible for it. After all, it is my name. And if I'm not careful, the actual value or worth of sushi might eventually drop. So thank you very much for your comments, but I'm not thinking about opening a restaurant abroad. Present.
Okay, I was wondering any other questions from the working press? If not, I have one question. I was just wondering, and we were talking about this before in the anteroom, regarding, with the global popularity of sushi, it's just sort of just exploding everywhere, and you see all kinds of types of sushi. Some of them are sometimes outright bizarre. But in terms of sort of the longer term future of sushi, there have been issues, in terms of tuna, in terms of the overfishing. And I've often wondered, whether like my daughter, my granddaughter, 20 and 30 years from now, will be able to eat, simple things like maguro sushi.
はい、私の方からも質問がございます。先ほど控室でちょっとこの件についてお話したんでございますが、今寿司ブーム、世界中の寿司ブームになっております。しかしながらそれに伴いいろんなその問題点が出てきているわけでございます。例えば魚の乱獲などの問題が出ているわけでございます。ですので長期において寿司の世界はどうやって変わる、発展すると思いますでしょうか。例えばそのマグロの乱獲という問題もありますので、私は時々自分の娘あるいは自分の孫娘、いずれ生まれるかもしれません、孫娘が20年30年先マグロを食べれるのかどうかというふうにさえも考えるんですが、いかがでしょうか。
マグロとかの食材の乱獲があって、はい、この間長期にかこれから先このお寿司マグロでもその魚を食べることができますでしょうか。
これはこの前も話したやつ これは私3年ほど前にあと5年経ったらこの材料が全部変わってくるだろうということを、うちの店の若い者に皆言ってたんですけれども、それが今現実に、徐々にそういうふうになっていくような気がいたしますので、将来現在の材料で寿司ができるということは全く考えられません。
Actually, 3 years ago, I remember gathering all of my apprentices and all of my staff before me and saying to them that the ingredients are changing so much. Things that were available in the past are becoming harder and harder to secure. As a result, I think 5 years from now, all of the ingredients will 100% change. Yet that was 3 years ago, and I feel that day has already come. It's not 5 years afterwards, but only 3 years afterwards. In other words, in response to your question, over the long term future of sushi, I don't believe that the current ingredients that we are using today will be available many years in the future.
Okay. Are there any other questions from the working press? If not, I'll open it up to the rest. You have one more quick question then? Okay, and then I guess, are you working press? Okay, and we'll go to you. And if we have time, we'll go over to you.
I think to have a 3-star restaurant brings some problems. I think a lot of people came with a lot of money but not understanding what they eat. They come to a 3-star restaurant for the reputation. So if they, these people come to your sushi restaurant, you see that these people don't understand what they eat. They have no knowledge, no tasting, no experience in tasting such things. How do you deal with this kind of behavior, even if you have this kind of high thinking about making sushi?
はい、三つ星レストラン、になるということは素晴らしいことだと思うんでございますが、しかしながらいろんな課題もそこ、から出てくるのではないかと思います。つまり、寿司の食べ方、寿司の伝統、寿司の歴史、まあ、寿司の味そのものについてあまり詳しくないお客様が大変多くいらっしゃるんじゃないかという気がいたします。まあ、お金をたくさん出せば有名なレストランに行けるっていう、そういう軽い気持ちで来る方もいらっしゃると思うんですが、一方では二郎さん、まあ、は非常にその、まあ、芸術的な考えを持ちながら、寿司を作ってらっしゃるんですが、そういうようなお客様にどう対応されるんでございますでしょうか。その考えの乖離、
うちの場合はいろんな方がお見えになりますけれども、食べ方がダメな方はこの食べ方をまず教えするわけですね。こうやって食べた方が美味しいですよ、こうやって食べますときれいに食べられますよっていうふうなことをお伝えするわけですね。でヨーロッパの方なんかだと、結構ご自分からお寿司が好きですけれども、どのように食べるとお寿司って美味しく食べれますか、私の食べ方を見て間違っていたら教えてくださいというようなお客様まで増えておりますので、とりあえずあまりにもひどかったらこういうふうに食べるとおいしく食べれますっていうことはお伝えしております。
Well, in our case, we have many, many different kinds of customers that visit our store. And if there are some people that are not very skilled or experienced at having sushi, we do sometimes very politely offer some advice that if you try to eat sushi in this way, it will be more tasty and it will be a neater way of having the sushi. Quite often, many people from particular European countries say on their own, I don't have much experience, I don't reallyeat sushi very often, so can you tell me how best to eat sushi, or if you watch me eating and I'm doing it wrong, will you please teach me? So again, it's a very friendly interaction where we try to offer advice to make their experience more enjoyable.
Sorry, I was just talking about the book. There's actually an interesting way of putting the soy sauce on the sushi netta, and I don't know if Mr. Ono, Yoshikazu Ono, could maybe explain a bit about this, because I thought it was very interesting. I've never seen this before.
この本の何ページ？78ページのところなんですけれども、お寿司に醤油をつけるというところの食べ方なんですが、お寿司大体外国人の方はご飯の方にお醤油をどっぷりつけて壊して食べちゃう方が多いわけです。で この酢飯の方っていうのは味がついておりますので醤油はつけない方がいいわけです。つけるんでしたら上の魚魚介の方へつけた方がいいわけです。でそのつけ方をこの78ページの方に書いてあるんですが、醤油小皿の中に、生姜ですね、ガリといいますか生姜をつけ込ん、つけまして上にあの魚醤油をつけた上にあの上の魚に塗って召し上がっていただけるとあの綺麗に召し上がれるという感じですね。
So,
言ってる意味はわかるかな。
Yes, I think you will all understand. I'm referring to page 78 of your little booklet. Quite often, some of our customers who come from other countries are not very experienced at having sushi, and they think that it's good to put the sushi rice into the soy sauce bowl. However, the rice itself is already flavored. It has a vinegar taste and also some sweetness and some saltiness. So you don't need to put soy sauce on the rice. If you do want to use soy sauce, what you should do is put some a little bit of soy sauce on the actual fish portion. However, you don't want to just flip the fish over or anything of the sushi over. What you want to do is you want to take a little bit of pickled ginger, which is always on the side of your plate, and dip that into the soy sauce, and again use that as a brush to lightly flavor your fish.
A gentleman over here, and then over here, and then if we have time, the woman over here on the right.
ディサイドの白尾と言います。小野さんにお伺いしたいんですが、あの二郎さんはますますもこうバーが高くなって我々が行けるような店じゃなくなってきてるように思うんですけど、あのそれで私あの吉野という京橋のお寿司屋さんに20年通ってるんですが、一時期小野さんは吉野におられたことがあるというふうに聞いたことがあるんですが、吉野で、水谷さんとか青木さんもおられたことがあるという聞いたんですが、影響を受けられたことがあるのか、何か勉強された学ばれたことがあったのか、もしあったら教えてください。
京橋の吉野で影響を受けたこと、それから勉強したこと、そういうことがあったら話していただけますか。
ちょっと待ってください。今
Jiro-san, your shop, you are becoming more and more famous, and it's becoming more and more difficult to ever enter your store. However, I often go to another very famous sushi shop called Yoshino in Kyobashi district of Tokyo, and I've been going there for about 20 years. I've heard that you have a relationship with this Yoshino restaurant that, as you mentioned earlier, Mr. Mizutami, Mr. Aoki also worked in your restaurant. So have there been things that you've learned from each other or influenced each other?
これは私があの寿司屋になりたくて、その吉野という寿司屋さんに修行に入ったんですけれども、
いくつの時、
これが26の時でございます。26歳の時に和食の方、和食はかな、和食の方から寿司の方に転向した年齢でございます。自分が26からですから、皆さんよりちょっと遅くなってますので、必死になって勉強したつもりでございます。それが現在、財産になって自分の体に残ってると思います。
吉野の親方の印象ないでしょう。
印象あまり良くないで。
So, yes.
でもマグロの握り
なんか。
これはね、あの吉野の親父さんっていうのは日本でも3人の中に入るという腕のいい国人さんだったんですけれども。サボることが好きな方でして、私はそれはあまり真似をしないで、自分なりに努力をしてきたつもりでございます。
So yes, Yoshino is a very, very famous sushi restaurant, and I entered the sushi restaurant as an apprentice when I was 26 years old. At that time, I had decided to switch from being a chef of other kinds of Japanese cuisine to just specializing in sushi. And so 26 at that time was rather late to be starting as an apprentice, and therefore I worked tremendously hard to try to catch up and to try to develop my own skills. And I think I learned a great deal there, and all of the things that I learned at working at Yoshino became part of the assets that have seeped into my own body. And therefore, I'm very, very grateful. And the question was further asked, what are your impressions of the head chef at Yoshino? And Ms. Jiro-san has kind of laughed and said, not very positive impressions that I've had. Of course, this person was one of the three great sushi chefs of his time, and he had tremendous skills, but he was also someone who kind of was a little bit lazy, lackadaisical, and didn't always focus on his work. And that is one thing that I did not copy from him.
Okay, the gentleman over here, and then we'll go over to the woman over here after him.
アソシエイトの本庄と申します。数ヶ月前にですね、ここに清水の末広寿司の板長さんが来られて、まあ、マグロのイベントっていうのがあって、おやりになって、その時にお話をされたんですが、マグロのその品質をですね、安定した品質のそのマグロをこの手に入れて、でそれをお客様にその提供するためには、やはり外洋のね、大西洋で取ってきたマグロを使わなくてはならないんで、自分たちはそういうものを使っとるんだということを言っておられたんですけども、大将はこれについてどういう具合にお考えか、どういうご見解をお持ちなのかというのをちょっとお聞きしたいんですけれども。
My name is Gonjo. I'm an associate member. And some time ago, we had the head chef of a place, of a restaurant called Suehiro Sushi. We had a tuna event, a maguro event. And he talked, the head chef spoke to us, and he talked about the importance of ensuring the high quality of tuna. And he said that in order to present a very stable, high quality tuna to our customers, we have to make sure that we get tuna only from what we call the open seas, the high seas, for example, the Atlantic Ocean. And he says, he said that we never take any other kinds of sushi. What do you think about his thoughts?
Mr. Ono.
I believe that that is actually true. What he says is absolutely true.
これは事実だと思います。そのくらい今はマグロが少なくなっておりますので、自分のいいのだけ狙っていてもなかなかこれは手に入らないと思います。
So I think nowadays, though, with tuna becoming so scarce in quantity, you have to be open to be able to use all kinds of tuna. You can't just simply aim for it. ちょっと今、すみません、強くよく分からなかったんですが、いいマグロしか狙ってもダメっていうことですか？
国産のマグロだけでは賄いきれないということだと思います。
ありがとうございます。What I mean is that you cannot only depend on domestic caught tuna, but you have to be able to open your mind to receiving tuna from other places, such as the Atlantic Ocean.
Would that also include like yoshoku or farm-raised tuna?
養殖マグロも考慮していただけるっていう、そういうようなお考えでございますでしょうか？
ゆくゆくはそういうふうになると思います。例えば今まではその何十年も前は輸入のマグロ、外国、今みたいに寿司ブームではなかったので、外国で取れたマグロはみんな日本に来てたわけですね。それがこの世界中寿司ブームになりましたから、その地元で取れたのは地元で取引する、外国で取引するということで輸入量が減ったわけなんです。その分足りない分をその日本でどういうふうにするかっていうことになりますと、やっぱり養殖マグロなんかを使わなければ賄いきれなくなると思います。だからゆくゆくはそういうふうになると思いません。うなぎなんかがその養殖は当たり前、天然というのは珍しいっていう風なスタイルでこうずっと来ていますので、寿司の方もゆくゆだんだんとそういう風になっていくんじゃないでしょうか。
I believe that in the future we will certainly be using farmed tuna. The reason for this is that it used to be that very few people ate sushi outside of Japan. As a result, almost all the tuna that was caught, whether near Japan or very far from Japan, was basically imported into Japan. There was a great deal of sushi available. However, nowadays, with the sushi boom, quite often a locally caught tuna is consumed locally, and there is less and less tuna that is being brought to Japan. So in the future, I believe that eventually we will have to turn to farmed tuna in the future. Already we're seeing this with yil unagi, because it's very rare nowadays to be able to find eel that have been caught in the wild. Most is farmed. And I think eventually that will happen for tuna as well.
Okay, and I think this is the last question from over here.
宇佐家東京坂本ゆかりと申します。一度だけ二郎さんで美味しい寿司いただいたことありますけど、私エビのアレルギーのありますので、で吉和さんが私に聞いて何か食べられないですか、でエビのアレルギーありますでエビとあと最後の卵も食べられなかった、その代わりちょっと変な質問だけど、その代わりに何も来てないから食べられないなら、他のレストラン行くときは光り物とかマグロ、それだけ今までずっと悩んでた、なんで私だけが18巻でお友達が20巻。ごめんなさい、すみません。
So, excuse me, I have a question. I was fortunate enough to visit Jiro-san's restaurant once, and it was a wonderful experience. However, I do have some allergies, food allergies. And when Yoshikazu-san asked me at the beginning, do you have any food allergies? I said, well, I can't have shrimp, and I can't have eggs. Normally when you go to a restaurant and you say that you cannot have certain foods, something else is presented in its stead. However, in your restaurant, that no alternatives were presented. Everybody else got 20 pieces of sushi, and I only got 18. And even now, I still cannot let go of that memory. What are your thoughts about this?
うちの場合はですね、すべてのものを全部お出ししている、その日に仕入れたものをすべてお出ししているわけで、そのアレルギーの方とかお嫌いな方っていうわけには、別のものは用意しているわけじゃないんですね。ですからそこから引いていただくしかないんです。あれで全部お出ししているわけなんです。だから他のものを出してくれと言われても出しようがないわけなんですね。その辺はちょっとご理解いただきたいと思いますが、はい。
So we are sorry about your experience. However, our fundamental policy is that we bring in all sorts of ingredients and we present everything that we have prepared that day. So if people have some allergies or if people do not like certain ingredients, we are very sorry, but there is nothing else in our kitchen for us to present.
それは自分が嫌いだから仕方がない。
嫌いだよね。アレルギ
ー。we actually have a bit more time. I thought we were going until 3:30, but we actually have until 4, so we can have some more questions. Gentleman in the back.
Hello, Giles Murray, Fortune Magazine. Thanks very much. That was a very entertaining talk. I have a question related to the book.Now, Japan has a lot of wonderful cuisine. It has a lot of wonderful photographers, but it seems that the Japanese public are reluctant to spend money on big books unless they have pictures of nude women. And I noticed that in this book, you've actually got some good photos and you've got higher production values, but at the same time, it's a kind of mini, mini Japanese size. Can you talk a little bit about the...production process for the book, and if you actually thought of the foreign audience when you decided to put some photos in it.
はい、フォーチュン氏の、記者でございます。日本は素晴らしいその、料理がたくさんございますし、素晴らしい写真家もいらっしゃると思うんでございます。しかしながらやっぱり非常にこの、本は小さいサイズでございますので、これについてちょっと注目してしまったんでございます。やはり日本の方たちと言いますのは、その大きな写真集をなかなか買わない、裸の女性が入ってないとなかなか買わないという、傾向があると思うんでございますが、この本のサイズについてちょっとご説明いただけますでしょうか。どういうようなその制作過程を経ましたんでしょうか。そしてまた最終的にその写真などを入れるときに、そのお客様がその外国人であるかもしれないというのはかなりどのくらい考えたんでしょうか。
Actually, we have someone from the publisher too. If I don't know if he wanted to comment, but I guess first we'll go to Yamamoto-san.
そうですね。出版社の方も今日聞いてらっしゃると思うんでございますが、とりあえず山本様から。はい
二郎さんのところではすでに何冊も大きなカラー の本が出てます、ビッグサイズの。よく外国のところのレストランの料理の本と同じようなものが。ですからこのハンドブックというか、ちっちゃいサイズのものっていうのは今までいなかった二郎さんの本なので、それと皆さんが手軽にこう見られるっていう、そういうサイズのものを出したいなということが第一のものです。で、1000円ということなので、たくさんの方にお読みいただければいいなと。あと、二郎さんのお店でとてもよくお土産に持って帰られます。1000円という金額が出しやすいんだと思うんですけども、それで後でこう楽しんでいただけるということもあって、
ってこのサイズになりました。
I would like to first of all explain that there are already several books that have been produced which are very large in size and are full of beautiful glossy pictures, very similar to the kind of photograph books that are produced for other famous restaurants. However, I think this is the first time that we've had this kind of small handbook produced, something that one can buy and hold and walk around with very easily. Also, the fact that it's only priced at 1,000 yen makes it very, very accessible. In fact, when many people visit Jiro-san's sushi shop, quite often they buy this as a souvenir to take home with them. They want to read it at their leisure later. I think 1,000 yen makes it a very good price point.
James-san にお願いなんですが、皆さんきっと4月に来日されたアメリカのオバマ大統領が次郎さんのところで、非公式ながら国賓として来日しながら非公式ながら銀座の寿司屋で食事をしたっていうことは非常に異例なのでその真実がどんなものだとかきっとお聞きになりたいんじゃないかなと思うんですね、オバマは本当に食べなかったんじゃないかとかいろんな見もしないことをみんな言ってるのでそこの本当のところをほんの少しだけご本人および吉勝さんが目の前にいて一番の証言者ですからそこのお話を皆さんにちょっと最後だけ聞いていただきたいんですがいかがでしょうか。
あ、はい、お願いします。
Since we have this opportunity for Jiro-san and Yoshikazu-san to be here, we'd like to ask them a little bit about Mr. Obama's visit in April. As you know, he was the official guest of the national government. Yes, yet he was taken to a private little sushi shop in Ginza. There have been many rumors circulating around his visit. Some people say that he didn't actually eat the sushi. But what was the actual truth of his visit? Please describe them for us.
で、Yoshikazu-san に伺いますけど、伺ったのは1週間前にお話があったそうなんですよね。
はい、官邸の方からは1週間前に突然貸し切りでお願いしたいということを言ってきたんですが手前どもの方はもう予約がいっぱいだったので最初はお断り申し上げたんです。でしたら閉店後でも構わないからということでお受けすることになりました。
Yes.
アメリカ側の要求というかお願いということだったんですよね結果。
その辺はちょっと分からないです。とりあえず首相官邸の方のご招待ということなんですが。
So yes, only a week before the visit, the Prime Minister's residence office called us and said we'd like to completely reserve the entire restaurant. And we told them that this was impossible. It was a great honor, but we were completely reserved, full, and so we could not accept this. We said no originally. However, they said that after your regular customers have been served, we would like to have a special visit then. And so yeah, we said yes. And Mr. Yamamoto was asking, this request originated from the American side. Is that correct? And Yusukazu-san's answer is that we do not know the details.
その後は、
はい、
あとその最初はいたずら電話かと思ったんです。
And actually, our first reaction was, this can't be true. Someone's playing a trick on us.
それから次の日外務省から電話がありまして、でその外務省の方が来られて、でいろいろ話を伺うことになりました。で結局お受けするということになりましたらその日から警備に入るようになりました。1週間丸々警備でしたね。
So originally we thought it was a prank call. However, the next day the Ministry of Foreign Affairs called and a representative from the ministry came and visited us and spoke with us. And so we decided, yes, that we would accept this special reservation. From the moment that we said yes to this visit, we were surrounded by security guards, in other words, the Secret Service.
それで当日皆さんもご存知のようにすごい警備の中でご来店いただきまして、で召し上がっていただいたんですが、最初から難しい事務的な話に入られたので私どもはどうしていいか最初分からなかったんですけれども父が普通に出してくださいと言われたんでこういつも の先ほど召し上がったように普通のスタイルお任せコースですねあれをお出ししました。
So, as you know, the day of the visit approached, and I'm sure you've seen footage of the tremendous numbers of security guards that were Secret Service people that were around when Mr. Obama and Prime Minister Abe arrived. As soon as people sat down and the meal began, immediately the parties started a very, very difficult discussion about different important matters. At first, we on our serving side were not sure how to handle the situation. However, we had been told in advance that we should treat Mr. Obama and his party as any other guest. Therefore, we served the regular style, which was the 20-piece course.
で順番で食べていただいて、中トロの、中トロを大統領が召し上がっていただいた時にちょっと とても気に入っていただいたようなので、あのウィンクしていただきました。
So each of the pieces was served in its turn, and when we got to the chutoro, the medium fatty tuna part, apparently this was something that very much was liked by the president. The president had the chutoro and he immediately winked at us.
ね、まあ一通りお出しして、大統領お出ししたものは全部召し上がっていただきました。
And I would like to make this very clear. We served the regular 20-piece course, and the president was kind enough to eat every single piece.
その、か、あの、日米交渉の話がやっぱり長引いたので、あの、ぜ、あの、なんですかね、こう、味わって食べていただいたかどうかはちょっとわからないんですけれども、でも一応全部食べていただいて、今まで、あの、食べたお寿司の中では最高だっていうふうにおっしゃっていただきました。
The negotiations between the U.S. And, and Japanese side dragged on a little bit longer than perhaps he had expected. So as he was having this meal and these difficult negotiations were going, we do not know how much he was able to truly focus on and enjoy the sushi. However, as I mentioned earlier, he ate everything. And when he departed, he said, "Of all the sushi that I've had in the world, this is the best."
すみません、付け加えると、あの、食事中に私の人生の中で一番おいしいお寿司だっていうのをオバマ大統領は3度言われたらしいです。
If I may, because Yoshikaze-san is probably being very modest, I'd like to add that during the meal, President Obama said three times that this is the best sushi I've ever had in my life.
大統領は左利きで、お箸もとてもお上手に使われて、きれいに召し上がっておりました。
And President Obama apparently is left-handed, but he held his chopsticks very beautifully, very skillfully. He had everything on his plate in a very neat fashion.
お寿司がとても好きだっていうこともおっしゃっていました。
He also said that he loved sushi very much.
あと、あの、他の噂では予約を断って、一日貸し切りだったんじゃないかっていうんですけど、きちんとお昼のお客様、夜のお客様をこなした後やられたんですよね。
全部終わってからそれで貸し切りということですね。
And there have been some negative rumors that said that Jiro-san canceled the previous reservations so that Mr. Obama and his party would be able to have the complete restaurant to themselves, but that is not true. Jiro-san and his staff served their regular lunch customers, their regular dinner customers, and then, after everything had been done, they offered their services.
ですから、その晩予約された外国のお客様は、ジローのお寿司食べに行くのに、パスポートを見せて入ったらしいですね。
Apparently, the regular customers that day, especially in the evening, had to present their passports in order to get into Jiro-san's shop.
あと、あの、
週刊誌に2個しか食べなかったっていうの書いてあったって言うでしょ。
全く嘘。
いろいろマスコミの憶測があって、2個しか食べない、4個しか食べないとかいろいろ書かれておりましたけれども、私ども官邸とホワイトハウスの方から何もあのコメントしてはならんというふうに伝えられておりましたので、今までずっと話せなかったんですが、お出ししたものはもうみんな召し上がっていただきました。で、とても美味しかったというふうにおっしゃっていただきましたので、ありがたく思っております。
I would also like to mention, as has been brought up, there have been some negative reports in the media that President Obama only had 2 pieces or only 4 pieces of sushi and left everything else. Until now, we have been asked by the Prime Minister's residence and also by the White House not to talk about this visit by the President and his party. But I would like to explain that we're very, very grateful for the fact that the President, we presented the regular course and he ate every single piece and also said he loved it.
あと、あの、次郎さんの方から質問をあのしたらしいんです。首相官邸、外務省、どちらか目の前に包丁がありますが大丈夫でしょうかって。
And apparently, Jiro-san also asked a question. There were after all people with the Prime Minister's office and the Minister of Foreign Affairs. He said, "I'm going to be standing right in front of the President of the United States, and I'm going to be holding a knife. Is that permissible?"
大丈夫だ、まあ、あの、大丈夫だとはおっしゃらなかったですけど、はい、うちの仕事ができないので、
It's not that they were told it's all right, but rather if they had been told that they couldn't hold their knives, they could not have presented the work, they could not have done their work.
おそらくあの大統領が料理人が作ったものをダイレクトにその場でいただくというのは歴史上きっとなかったことではなかったかなというふうに思います、ね。
I believe that this is probably the first time in history that the President of the United States had something that was prepared for him and eaten directly and eaten that food directly after it was prepared.
でオバマ大統領が銀座のお寿司屋さんで食べたということが大事で、次郎さんの栄誉じゃなくて、つまり国賓でいらした世界で最も有名な大統領が、非公式ながら日本で国賓がいらっしゃる食事は皇居の方明殿か迎賓館と決まってるわけですよね。それが銀座のお寿司屋さんで食べたということで、オバマ大統領がお寿司をつまんだ瞬間、左利きですか、 つまんだ瞬間フランス料理のような世界の料理と同じグローバルスタンダードになった瞬間、これをニュースキャスターが誰も指摘してないっていうのがとても寂しいなと私は思いました。これが一番大事なことで、日本の寿司業界、去年和食が世界無形文化遺産になりました。それに追い風をするようなお寿司ということが非常にスタンドアップしたその瞬間だということを誰かニュースキャスターに言ってほしかったなというのが私の実感です。これが一番大事な点だと思います。私
And I would also like to add, I have been in the food industry for many, many years, and the fact that Jiro-san's restaurant was visited by President Obama is, of course, a very, very important thing. But what is important is not that he came to Jiro's restaurant, but that he, an official visitor of the national government, came and visited a private sushi shop during his stay. Normally, when a person is the guest, official guest of the national government, the only meals that he takes are from, are prepared by the Geihinkan, the national guest house of the government, or are otherwise prepared by the Imperial Household Agency.It is very rare that such a person would have just regular food. But the moment that the President of the United States, the most powerful person in the world, took a bite of this sushi, it immediately elevated the role of sushi to as high a level as French cuisine. And I think this is what was so outstanding and extraordinary about this event. And this is something that, as a food critic, I felt very, very sad about, because no newscaster, no news person focused on this point.As you know, sushi is now considered to be a world cuisine. It is listed by the UNESCO organization as being a world heritage asset. Again, this very important, momentous event for the world of sushi was not truly focused upon by the media.
Okay. Oh, do you have another question or comment? Okay, sure.
今吉和さんは次郎の2代目3代目はいらっしゃいますか
今のところまだです今のところは、はい、
So we know that 吉和さん is going to be the second generation owner of the restaurant. Is there a third generation yet? And not yet, apparently.
吉和さんの弟さんの高志さんが六本木のすき橋次郎六本木店というんで、すき橋次郎は今日本に2軒あります。
Actually, Yoshikazu-san has a younger brother whose name is Takashi Ono, and he runs another Sukiyabashi Jiro restaurant, which is located in Roppongi Hills in Tokyo.
Oh, go ahead. Right over here.
こんにちは。アソシエイトのヨネダと言います。ご無沙汰しています。まさかここでお会いすると思いませんでした。一つ、先ほどオバマ大統領を見えた時の話ですけど、オバマ大統領の時は、儲かりましたか、それから今度先生の方にちょっと一つお聞きしたいんですけど、今和食無形無形、文化遺産ということで非常に世界中で広まっていると思うんですけど、例えばフグの場合はフグの調理師の免許が別に必要になりますよね。でお寿司の場合にそういうことを、これからやっていくようなことを考えていらっしゃいませんか。
I'm an associate member. My name is Yoneda, and apparently I am a regular customer of Jiro-san's. I didn't expect to meet you here today. I have two questions. First of all, when President Obama came, did you make a lot of money? Were you able to make great profits? And the second question is for Mr. Yamamoto. You've repeatedly mentioned that sushi is becoming a world cuisine. It is listed by the UN as being an intangible cultural asset. However, when we look at, for example, fugu, which is a blowfish, in order to prepare blowfish because it has poisons in it, you have to have a special license to become a blowfish preparer. Are you thinking about the fact that perhaps there is a similar need to prepare a licensing system for sushi chefs?
I guess to Yoshikazu-san first and then to Mr. Yamamoto.
最初は儲かりましたかっていうご質問だと思うんでございます。
儲かるって普通にいただきました。それから少し貸切料をいただきました。
Yes, well, we just
時間外手当てっていうこと。閉店外ですから。閉店の後ですから。
So yes, we just made regular profits. I mean, we charged the normal fees for the meal, but he also completely rented out the place, and so we charged a little bit extra. We also added a little bit of overtime pay.
はい、私の方の質問ですが、日本料理が世界中に進出していく、中にはとても難しい問題がたくさんあって簡単にはいかないと思いますが、以前そういうことを検証するんではなく、なんか、取り締まるっていう形のように取られて、寿司ポリスなんていうような言い方されましたが、免許は別に調理師免許があればお寿司握れるんですよね。ですから日本ではそういう形、外国でもどんな形でもいいから、僕は和食はなかなか世界に広まっていくのは難しいと思いますが、お寿司はますます世界中に広まっていく素晴らしい食べ物だと思います。はい。
Thank you very much for your question. Yes, I believe that as sushi becomes more of a global cuisine, there are going to be some different challenges that face us. In fact, in the past, there were some discussions along the lines of which you just explained. However, some of the reactions were quite negative. We were thinking of trying to create some kind of standards for sushi preparation, but we were roundly criticized as being sushi police. I think eventually, though, if you can have some kind of a system that will guarantee a certain quality of sushi preparation, that would be a good idea. In Japan, you don't have to have a special license for preparing sushi, but you do have to have a chef's license. You have to have a cooking license in order to be able to prepare sushi. I think something like that, because sushi is such a wonderful thing, and we do want it to become more of a global cuisine, something like that might be considered in the future.
Okay, I guess we'll go maybe just one more question. I guess over to you, and then...to you, and I think that'll be it.
Kyoto's kaiseki ryori is also regarded as a top Japanese kind of cooking. Is there any relationship? Is there any between both? Did in the past kaiseki and sushi cooking influence each other?
はい、京都の、懐石料理というのも非常に高く評価されているわけでございます。和食、の代表的なものだというふうに言われているんでございますが、寿司文化と、寿司の世界と懐石の世界は何か関係はあるんでございましょうか。どっちかがどっちかを影響したかとか、何かそういうつながりというのはありましたんでしょうか、過去においても。
どうでしょうね。はい、簡単に言いますと、関西の方は、デパートメントストアですね、オールラウンダー。東京の方はブティックですね、専門、同じ仕事を何十年やり続ける、一つの仕事を進化させていく、向こうとこっちは関東大震災の後に関西の料理がやってきましたけど、基本的にはそういうふうに違う、ですからマスターの呼び方も、日本料理、和食、懐石料理は大将と言いますが、職人のトップにいる人は親方と言います、大将と、寿司屋の親方と言って寿司屋の大将とは言いません。それぐらいに大将と親方という言い方が違う。それと同じように向こうの関西の料理が日本に東京にやってきましたけど、基本的には東京はお寿司屋さんお寿司だけ、天ぷら屋さん天ぷらだけ、そういうブティックですね。関西はデパートメントストアです。いろんなものを売ってる、いろんなものを作る、それが例としていいかなと。
そうですね、東京の場合っていうか日本の場合ですね、普通はもう懐石、外国でもそうですけど、レストランということになると懐石みたいになるんですが、専門職で、つまり寿司、天ぷら、うなぎとか、そういう専門職一種類だけやってて、高級店っていうのは日本にしかないわけですね。他の国にはスパゲティとかピザだけで高級店っていうのは多分ないと思うんです。そのぐらい日本の食文化っていうのはその多岐にかけているわけで、その辺がいろいろ皆さんこう評価するのが難しいんだと思いますけれども、そういう日本の食文化、独特の食文化っていうのもその素晴らしさがあるのを皆さんにもっと分かっていただきたいなっていうふうには思います。
So fundamentally, the difference between Kaiseki, which has its roots in the western Japan or Kansai area, and what we have in Tokyo, I think if we were to compare the different kinds of cuisines, you could say that in Kansai, they believe in the department store approach. In other words, Kaiseki, as you know, has many courses, many different kinds of varieties of dishes. However, in Tokyo or Edo, the style is boutiques. In other words, you have specialty shops specializing in one kind of cuisine, such as, for example, sushi, tempura, etc. In fact, there is a fundamental difference between these kinds of approaches, because in the Kansai, when you have the head chef of a Japanese cuisine restaurant, which serves many different kinds of Japanese cuisine, his title is Taisho, which means sort of like general leader, I guess might be a direct translation. Whereas with the sushi chefs or the unagi or other specialty shops that you have in Tokyo, the top person is not called Taisho, but is rather called Oyakata, which means a little bit like a parent, a father, the big boss. And so you can see that it's a very much of a craftsmanship kind of approach. And Yoshikazu-san has also added that the kaiseki cuisine can be considered a restaurant kind of cuisine where one shop serves many different kinds of foods. However, what's distinctive about the shops that you find in Tokyo are the ones that specialize only in one kind of cuisine. They specialize only in one kind of cuisine, like tempura or eel, unagi or sushi, but they take it to a very, very high level. And that kind of restaurant, specializing only in one kind of food but taking it to a very high level, does not exist anywhere else in the world. It's one thing that is very, very distinctive about Tokyo. For example, you might have stores in other countries that specialize only in spaghetti or only in pizza, but they're usually not of the very high quality or high level or high artistic standards that we find in Tokyo.
Okay, so this will be the last question.
Meiji 23年、徳富蘇峰創刊、国民新聞論説委員の藤田博之と申しますけども、親方にお伺いしたいんですが、昨今テレビを見てますとですね、世界中にいわゆる寿司屋といいますか、そういうのが広まってて、それは大変結構なことなんですが、私ども一般的に日本人の感覚からするとですね、とても寿司とは思えないようなネタがですね、突拍子もないネタとか突拍子もないその何て言うんですかね、ソースとかいろんなものをかけたりとかっていうのがあるんですね。また別な番組でこの間たまたま見てたら、そのフランスの方だったと思いますけども、その私は江戸前と同じようにこのフランスでですね、その取れる食材魚を使ってこの本当 の, その伝統的な寿司の精神をこうフランスの人に伝えたいというシェフの方といいますか、親方ですかね、フランス人のだったと思いますけどいらっしゃって、こういう方はですね、大変私も素晴らしいなと感銘を受けたんですが、その辺でこれは今後こういう寿司がグローバル化していく中で、ここまでは寿司だけどここから寿司じゃないとかですね、なんかそういう線引きっていうのはこれは すべきなのか、あるいは考えてらっしゃるのか、どう思ってらっしゃるのか、その辺ちょっとお伺いしたいなと思いまして、よろしくお願いします。
So I'd like to ask Jiro-san, the Oyakata, when we watch television nowadays, we see that sushi has become worldwide, a global thing, but we have very, very strange kinds of sushi from our point of view anyway, where you use unusual ingredients and different sauces. So in fact, I was watching, however, a French sushi chef who said he was trying to respect the traditions of edamame sushi and trying to take locally caught ingredients and prepare them in that way. But the point is, what I'm saying is that as sushi becomes more and more of a global cuisine, do you think that somewhere along the line, a line will need to be drawn that says outside of this realm is sushi and inside this realm is sushi, and outside of this realm it is no longer sushi?
そしたら小野さんお願いします。
これは日本だけだったらそういうふうにした方がいいかなと思いますけれども、今世界中でお寿司をブームになっていますので、その国その国のやり方があると思いますから、これはそういうふうに規制してしまってもあんまり良くないんじゃないかなと私は思いますけれども、日本だけだったらやった方がいいような気がしますけどね。だから世界中でやっだったらちょっとそれは難しいんじゃないかなと思いますけれど。
I certainly understand your concerns, and I think if we were only talking about Japan domestically, then I think perhaps some kinds of lines need to be drawn, definitions perhaps need to be made. However, as you've pointed out, sushi is now a global cuisine, and I think each nation, each country, each culture has its own way of thinking about food and handling food. So I think placing some kinds of restrictions would not only be difficult, but perhaps would not be a positive thing for sushi.
Okay. Well, I think we've run out of time, but I'd like to thank our three guests today, Mr. Yamamoto and Mr. Yono and Mr. Ono. It was very, very fascinating discussion, and actually, it was actually good to hear something that was, you know, sort of mouth-watering, and we're probably thinking about sushi right now. But I'd like to thank our guests, and as in our regular tradition, we'd like to give our three guests today an honorary membership for 1 year. And hopefully we'll see them, maybe even in the sushi bar. Thank you.
本当に素晴らしい美味しいお話ありがとうございました。で、ゲストスピーカーの方たちに1年有効の名誉会員賞を差し上げたいと思いますので、ぜひ遊びに来てください。我々の方にも寿司バーがありますので、ぜひそこの方にもいらしてください。1
年有効の、まあ、名誉会員なんだそうです。ありがとうございます。ありがとうございます。1年だけじゃなくてずっとでもいいですよね。はい。